Cool beans.
All right, everybody. Good morning, good morning. Welcome to the HWMF Podcast. I'm your host, Seth Feroce, here with my heterosexual life mate, the Iron Man himself, Mr. Bobby Dautrich.
Good morning.
And I'm here with the two dickheads as well. They're here in this. Jay and Shane, say hello to everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning.
They're so fucking enthusiastic. We got an Iron Man here, and you two just sitting there lollygagging the fuck around.
I lost my enthusiasm yesterday when I said hi to him.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Yeah, he's been here for a minute. This is just everybody's first time. You're supposed to be excited.
You were very excited to see me yesterday.
I was.
It was the most, like, uplifting, like, hey, I've gotten from him in a while.
It's so. Like I was getting beaten the whole day here, and then you showed up to save me.
Yeah. Shane's like everybody's dick through quarantine, just fucking pounded to death.
It looked
getting fucking pounded every day, multiple times.
Uh-huh.
You know, all beat up and bruised and battered and skinned and chafed, kind of like you.
Yeah, a little bit, yep. We're about the same week.
Yeah.
Mine just ended with a medal, and his just ended with more.
A paycheck that he gets every other week.
Yep.
His is more of a mental beating. Yours was kind of a physical,
yeah,
and mental.
Yep.
I gotta be. I'm excited because, we had Kenny on,
yeah,
who is the Iron Man dad,
mm-hmm,
and you're the co-host of the show. And I've been like the Mr. Bodybuilder. I've accomplished so many great things, but you and I have done all this greatness together from a business standpoint.
Yep.
And now from a physical standpoint, this is a notch on the belt.
Yeah.
I don't even know how many people have ever done this, but it's not as many as I'd think.
No, I don't know that statistic, but it's few and far between.
So now the co-host of the show that everybody listens to and knows, we're like, when we're on here, we're complete jerk-offs.
Uh-huh.
Yet we've done some pretty cool stuff, and usually we take off our mentally stable caps and usually fuck off on here for a couple hours.
Mm-hmm.
You've accomplished something that inspired a ton of people out there through, yeah, Kenny.
Yeah.
And this whole fucking takes on the journey. I'm,
yeah,
excited for everybody that is getting up to speed. You saw Bob, like, all chiseled jawline now, good looking and handsome. Not that you weren't before.
Thanks.
He was a little thicker.
Yep.
Kind of like me now.
Just like more loving, you know?
It's a real thing.
It is.
It's a real thing. But over, it was 200, I think Shane did the math, 208 days,
yeah,
before your Ironman.
Mm-hmm.
You were 250 some pounds,
yep,
running no miles, mm-hmm, swimming no laps,
yep,
biking no hills or nothing.
Nothing.
And with 208 fucking days, you turned into an Ironman.
Yeah.
And an Ironman, for everybody listening that doesn't know already, I'll repeat it again, 2.4 mile swim. Mm-hmm. Out of the water, put on new shoes and a new outfit and bike for 112 miles.
Yep.
And then after you're done biking 112 miles, you hop off that thing, run a full marathon, 26.2 miles.
Yep.
For an end result of 140.6 fucking miles in one day.
One day. 17 hours or less is the requirement.
And if you don't do it in 17 hours, you are not an Ironman.
Yep.
Technically.
Yeah, you're not.
They won't announce your name.
Nope. Nope.
I got so many messages throughout the day as you were being tracked.
Yeah.
From people saying, there's no fucking way I would ever do this.
Yeah.
Like, it's one of those things that nobody wants to do.
No. It's the same thing I said when Kenny was here on the podcast. I was like, there's no way.
No way.
There's no way I would even try to do that. I wouldn't even try to train for that. You know, I was a little bit intrigued about, like, starting to run when he was on, and, like, I was intrigued about maybe biking someday, but never, ever training all three of them to go do an Ironman.
Fuck no.
Fuck no.
I remember sitting here laughing and busting your balls because, mm-hmm, you know, we bust each other's chops pretty hard here at this office.
Yep.
Shane, you know that.
I don't know anything about that.
Poor guy.
He doesn't know anything about dishing it out. It's great at taking it.
Hold on. Did you listen to the podcast, Bob, by chance? Like, wait, the last one, 76?
No, not all of it. No.
So Seth and I took the, we would bet on you for the Ironman.
Yeah.
And we took the under. But we were going to be right regardless because it was 17 and a half.
Yeah.
Like hours.
Yeah. They were right. Like, somebody's like, oh, if you complete the Ironman in 17 hours, like, it's a pretty good job.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, that's the cutoff. And we're like, yeah, the under.
Yeah.
And then, like 3/4 of the way through the race, we're like, we're way off.
Yeah.
Way off. Yeah. But what's cool is this whole process, we didn't really talk too much about it other than your training and kind of was nonchalant about this whole process.
Yeah.
And now what people have seen you do, it's inspired a lot of people.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a lot of the whole process that people didn't see, that we didn't talk about on here, that I may not have talked about with anyone yet. And I think I tried to do that early on when I first started. You know, my goal was to document as much as I could and keep people informed. And that was a whole job in itself.
Yeah.
You know, and that fell at the wayside pretty quickly, just because it was hard enough to stay on the schedule for me to hit all my workouts for me personally, but yet alone to document it, to run these businesses, to find some normalcy at home. I think I did two videos on it, and then that was it.
Well, it's also the thing that, like, whenever you document everything, you're only documenting the good stuff.
Right.
We noticed that with me. Mm-hmm. We only documented all the good stuff.
Yeah.
We don't document the real stuff. We talk about the real stuff after it's occurred.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And that's part of the process of this, because everybody that watches a YouTube video, everybody loves to look at a train wreck.
Mm-hmm.
But then, like, whenever nobody likes to, like, really watch it intently because it's negative and it's tough.
Right.
So we like to document all the good stuff. And sometimes it's best just to be a little quiet.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't have changed the way I did it at all, because I think I would have, I wouldn't have been able to engulf myself in the process as much as I did trying to. I'd almost be lying to myself, like, by putting out all just the good.
Sure.
You know, and there was so many behind the scenes stuff with me and Kim personally that she's put up with, and we've battled through just to get the training started, but then to really dig deep, like, those last 10 weeks, 8 weeks.
That's kind of what I was getting at.
Yeah.
What are you going to do? Go on and put up a video being like, so my wife just told me I'm a fucking asshole.
Yeah.
And that I need to cut the bullshit. I feel really good about it, too. Yeah. I can't wait to run later.
Yeah, so you know what I did? I actually just, I left anyway, and I went and swam at 5 in the morning. I'll be home at 8 o'clock tonight. We can talk about it then.
Yeah.
After my bike ride.
Yeah, after that.
At 10 o'clock.
Whenever I get home, like, I don't really want to talk to her because it's going to be trouble, so I just want to focus on my training. That's why within bodybuilding, I said the same thing. I'm 6 weeks out. I stopped talking.
Yeah.
What do you mean you stopped talking? Yeah, I don't converse with anybody because
mm-hmm.
I'm going to win the fucking show. That's my goal.
Yeah.
My goal isn't, like, to talk to you and actually have, like, a nice conversation. It's winning.
Yep.
Because if I win, big things are going to happen for me.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's the intense parts.
Yeah, and those are some of the things you even told me in the beginning that were going to occur, because you knew the sacrifice and the things I'd have to do to actually legitimately be prepared to just complete the day. You knew from a bodybuilding perspective, the amount of work, the amount of time, the amount of relationships that you kind of fuck with. And I was warned very early on about all those things.
But the thing is, we talk about it on here a lot, because the sacrifices that we make at this business,
mm-hmm.
are the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it infiltrates your life, and it's going to, and we tell everybody it's going to infiltrate your life. However, what it does is it's testing your character, and it's testing your relationships in your life.
Yep.
Because without Kim, you wouldn't have completed this.
No way.
Kim didn't run one lick of the fucking Ironman.
Nope.
But behind the scenes, she was the support beam holding you up.
Yep.
And those types of people in your life, you need those types of people in your life to make sure that you're able to do great things, and it doesn't go unrecognized, and it doesn't go, it's those things that, it's some of the things that's tough as, I mean, I've never been that person,
mm-hmm.
like in a situation, like of a relationship, but like that person has so much strength and stability.
Yeah.
And is so, they're like, they're solid rocks, dude.
Yeah.
They're hard to fucking shake,
mm-hmm.
because those people don't get a lot of notoriety. Like, everything that you've done, I'm not running no fucking Ironman. Kim didn't run no Ironman. However, what she did is how you completed this.
Yeah.
And to be that person, and for every female or male, whoever it is, to be that person is incredibly difficult.
Yes. It's probably harder than going through the training and doing the race. Because I saw it tax her, and it's not that I disregarded it. I accepted that she was being taxed more than I was, and I knew that she was doing it from a good standpoint, that she loved me and she wanted to see me do these big things. But, you know, we pushed through it together.
Oh, and, yeah.
And, you know,
and that's the process here. And now, and it's not that I want to use this terminology or anything, but it's like, it's the whole process of now that it's the race is over. Mm-hmm. We get time together. Let's calm down. Let's get back to it. Because she knows you're not normal.
Yeah. Yeah.
That fucking thing's long gone.
Long gone, dude.
So it's more or less, we just get a couple fucking weeks.
Yeah, please.
I would really like to snuggle until maybe 5:15 in the morning.
Yeah.
Instead of 3:30 waking up for you to have your coffee, take a shit, and go swimming.
Yep.
Really like to snuggle till 5:15.
Oh, I know.
So that's that goes with anything that anybody does. Even, you know, I was with my dad last night, my psychopathic dad, mm-hmm. who's been retiring for 10 years now.
Yep.
Has more money to know what to do with, has done super well for himself. He's still like, you know, next year, it's like, I was going to stop, but
I got a new plan.
That's it.
5 years.
5 more years. Oh my God. Just shut the fuck up, Dad. He's so simple. And it's like,
we all have that piece in us, dude.
And it does. My dad's not running no fucking Ironmans. He's just a businessman.
Yeah.
He just can't stop. He's a stupid old Italian.
Yep.
You know?
You're not getting it.
And my mom, I'm like, man, you're a bad bitch. Yep. I definitely killed this motherfucker.
Years ago.
And now I go home. I went home. Uh-huh. I got home last night after being at the house with them. And get home. I look at the clock and I'm like, it's 9:10. I'm like, I am my father.
Yep.
Fuck me.
Yep.
I just got done saying how strong my mom is. And I'm like, you're like my mom.
Yep.
Fuck me. I'm so sorry.
I'm so sorry. Please don't kill me.
Don't kill me. I'm imagining that there's times at nighttime she's looking over me and I'm like, I didn't wake up to get SJ or something, and she just look at me, I'd like to choke you. I'll fucking kill you.
Just feel her presence.
I love you so much, but I fucking hate you right now.
That's where it's at, man.
I'll wake up well rested, snuggle over to her. Hey. She's like, you slept for 6 hours. Fuck off. Yeah, get the fuck away from me. No, so the Ironman dude.
Yeah.
He left on Monday.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we went down Monday. We went back home. We had to fly out of Philly. I had to drop the dog off at my family's, and we flew down to Panama City on Tuesday. So full day of travel, which, you know, that's always fun to begin with, yet alone with all the COVID bullshit, traveling with all the Iron Man gear, like all the fuck, dude, I had 3 suitcases of shit, you know, and the plan was get down there Tuesday so like I could get into this like normal routine of like my eating, my sleeping, some training, get used to the heat because it was humid and hot down there. And it kind of worked. Like once we got there, I was like, oh, this is going to be good. I'm so much more relaxed. And then about after like 3 or 4 hours there, I'm like, fuck, like I can see everything that I'm going to be doing all week. My nerves went through the fucking roof.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, just because like they put buoys out almost day two that I was down there.
So like Wednesday.
Yeah, and I could see them from our balcony in the condo.
I want to stop you right there.
Yeah.
Sorry. I'm going to interrupt you like 100 times.
Yeah, please.
Just so everybody listening knows, we watched the stories.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You like hopped right in the fucking ocean that day.
Yeah.
Like you just were like, yeah, let's go for a fucking swim.
Yeah. Before Kenny got there, like it was the most daunting thing I could have seen was like, oh fuck. Like we swam out and around the pier twice, and the pier was 300 yards from our balcony. Like that's the first thing I saw when we checked in. And I'm like, fuck, like I have to get in there as soon as possible. And me and Kenny had plans to swim half the course, so 1.2 on like Thursday. But I needed to get in there as soon as possible on my own, even if it was for like 20 minutes, even if it was just like wading in the water. So I wasn't there too long. And I was like, I'm putting the wetsuit on, I'm going down and getting in the water. And she's like, Kim was like, you sure? Like, you're going to be good. I'm like, I have to be good. I was like, I have to race out there on Saturday. So Wednesday morning, it was like 6:30. I started to walk down to the beach, put all my shit on. And I'm looking at the water, there's a couple people out swimming, and I'm like, they have to be here for Ironman, had swim caps on. No one else is swimming.
Fuck no.
At that hour of the day. And I literally sat there on like the edge of the sand for like 25 minutes, and I was like, I didn't know what to do. It's like I completely forgot like that aggressive instinct I had of like getting in the pool and hammering a fucking workout. So like I'm sitting there, I'm listening to music, trying to get like amped up, and I'm like, this isn't working. Like I'm not getting excited about this. I'm getting like more scared. So I eventually had all my shit on, got into the water. It was like waist height. It was chilly. It was the morning, and it was just taking my breath away. Like I couldn't get like a, I was like, I'm like, fuck no, the wetsuit's too tight. It's the wetsuit. And I'm like, no, it's me. It's the fucking nerves.
Wow.
And finally got my whole body like in the water wet and like felt like I was never uncomfortable going in the ocean. Like I always spend so much time in the ocean when we vacation.
I don't like it.
So I go out a little bit more till I'm like, my feet aren't touching the ground or anything. And I'm like, okay. I'm like, I know the distance I have to swim past this pier is like twice the length of the pier. So like, I think the pier was like maybe 500 yards out, and we were swimming like 1200 yards out before we turned to come back in.
That's one lap.
Yeah. 1.2 miles full lap. So I was like, okay. Whoa. I was like, I'm going to just swim to the end of the pier. 500 yards usually takes me like 10 minutes, you know, to do like 500 yards. I was like, real quick, just out and back, loosen up. So like I start to swim, like head goes underwater, and I'm like, whew, whew, like breathing heavy without even working hard. I'm like, fuck. I'm like, I need to calm down. So like I just started swimming even slower, just going through the motion, and then it like my training like kind of took over, like started to, and like my breathing was normal. I'm like, okay, there's my breaths. There's my heart rate's usually pretty low when I swim, like 120, 130. And it dropped, it was at like 160 just because of like I'm panicking.
Fuck yeah.
So it dropped down. I didn't look at my watch the whole time because I was like, I just need to focus on staying calm. And I just started swimming straight out. It was calm, like glass, you know, that first day I was in there. So I'm swimming, I'm watching the pier because I breathe to my right, and I get to the end of the pier, and like the water gets dark then because it gets deep. And I'm like, fuck. I'm like, okay, now I can no longer see the bottom. I can't see shit now. So like I started to panic a little bit more, and I'm like, I was like, I swam to the end of the pier, I'm gonna go back. So I swam back in. And I swam hard because I just wanted to get the fuck out of the water to process like what I just did. So I swam all the way back, got out of the water. I was like, man, I was in there for like a half hour. I was in there for like 9 minutes.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
And like I swam it really fucking fast. Like I didn't even know. Like I thought I was swimming nice and smooth and calm. And I was like hammering my swim, like best time I've ever had.
Oh my God.
Doing 500 yards, you know. So I got in, got out, pulled my wetsuit down, and I'm like, I was like, I think I'll be fine. I think I can actually do this. Like, I was like, I'm not going back in there right now. Oh my God. Like, I couldn't get back in because like, everything was telling me I should have worked out for like 30 minutes, been out there another 20 minutes or whatever. I was like, nope, that's it. It's all I can handle emotionally for today.
Man.
So that was Wednesday morning.
I would have lost my shit.
Dude, it was wild. Like, it scared the shit out of me
initially.
What
scared you in the water? Was it the water itself, or was it like...
Nothing ran by me like, oh, I'm going to see a shark, or I'm going to see this. None of that fucked with me. It was just the fact of, like, it's so vast, dude. Like, seeing it is so... It's so much bigger than...
Anything in the fucking
world? Like I swam that open swim at that lake.
Yeah,
you know,
Marine State Park.
Yeah, which was daunting. The bridge in the distance was our mile marker, and I was like, fuck, that is far. That was nothing compared to where this buoy was. You know, and this distance. And I was like, if I can do it in there and I can do it in the pool, it's the same workout. There's the only variables are waves, current.
And you didn't have any that morning.
And I didn't have any that morning. It was flat. I'm like, I'll be good.
I would have lost it. I can't do the ocean.
Dude,
I can't fucking do it.
Yeah.
Because me, I'm thinking about the animals in there, mm-hmm. the fishes, the sharks, mm-hmm. you name it. I'm like, man, they're going to get me like something. Mike's like, dude, he's like, sharks are like fucking bears. Mm-hmm. They're typically more scared of you than that. They usually scurry away. I'm like, yeah, I still don't fucking like it, though.
No.
In general. Maybe I'm like just tasty. I don't know. But after getting past that, because I had to thinking about you, I was like, man, like all this. And I'm like, what's more scary than a shark? And then I'm like, how about actually fucking drowning in the goddamn ocean because you're nowhere near the fucking land. You're in open water.
I know. That's what I...
That's fucking terrifying.
That was running through my head, too. It's like, what if I got burned out there? What do I do? I'm not just this fucking floating buoy that I can just float there and like rest and then like go back at it. It's like, no, I don't float anymore. I don't.
Yeah, that's a good question. Like, how was your buoyancy?
Yeah, did you lose buoyancy?
Well,
you fat fuck.
Yes, I have. Swimming in the pool, like, I am not buoyant. Like, I don't float.
I was right. I know. 7 months ago, I was right.
You were. Being in the ocean, though, in a wetsuit, you are incredibly buoyant.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah. Like, I could just lay on my back and just float there. But it's the ocean, dude. You got waves, you got currents, got fucking...
Well, fast forward here for a second.
Yeah.
You were doing all that. You went out and did a 1.5 mile swim with Kenny,
mm-hmm.
and it was a little choppy.
Really choppy.
And then the next day on race day, it wasn't like glass.
Bro, it was rough.
It was rough waters.
It was bad. Like, anyone that's been in the Gulf or like Florida waters, even when it's like a rough day, like the waves crashing on the shore, like knee height, like they're like 6-8 inches tall. You're like, oh, wow, this isn't like Ocean City, Maryland.
Yeah,
you know, you're like, oh, wow.
5 foot waves.
And then you're on the shore and you see that in the Gulf and you're like, oh, it looks so flat out there. So once you get past what's breaking on the sand, it's actually much bigger out there. You just don't, it's not curling and crashing, but it's still putting you up and down. So we swam Thursday, 1.2 miles, all the way out past the buoys and back in up over the sand, like simulating that first lap. And I start to swim and I notice like with every right stroke, I'm missing the water. There's no water there. Like I'm whiffing it because the wave's putting you up and down. And I'm like, fuck, I'm like, how am I going to get traction here? So like you start having to adjust your stroke, like where it was like a nice, like there's like a cadence to your stroke, you have to manipulate it based on the waves. So like with me, I breathe, my breathing dictates my cadence and my speed. So like you have to adjust it all to like just get that scoop of water and get you moving forward. Cause if you miss too many of those, dude, it's like you're going backwards.
Yeah, because it's like just like rowing a boat, except you're rowing your body.
So I swam with Kenny Thursday. It was rough. I got out. My inner thighs and my groin were cramping. My glutes were cramping up after one lap.
On Thursday.
Because I never had to sight like over waves. So it's like arching your back the whole time while you're trying to swim. And it cramped everything up. And I'm like, fuck, dude. Like if I feel like this after one lap on Saturday, like I might be fucked. Because the idea is you don't use your lower body to swim because you want them to be fresh. So Saturday morning came. I look out on the balcony and you can hear the waves now. Like before you just saw them like, oh, little waves. Now you could hear them. Like you could hear them crashing into the beach. So we're down there. They lined us up. They seated us by like how long we thought it would take us to do the swim. So they called like anyone that hour and 20 minutes to hour and 30 minutes, come forward. We'll walk you over to the water. That's what they did. And when I was like 50 yards from the water and I saw how these waves were crashing that close to the shore, I knew getting out there, it was going to be mayhem. Like it was going to be intense.
So did you attack it going out there? Were you like, fuck yeah. Did you like run in like fucking Mitch Buchanan?
No. So like that was always my mentality with it.
Yeah.
And Kenny and Scott told me to not do that because running through the sand and through those waves, you know, it's like trudging. Like you're like skipping through, like trying to pull your feet out. He's like, the worst thing you could do is do that and pull something in your hamstring. Like even getting out on that second lap, he's like, bro, don't run out of that water. Like just walk out of the water. Because if I would have pulled something, dude,
that
could have been game over for the whole day.
Yeah, you didn't practice running in fucking sand.
Right.
And you're Mitch Buchanan out there.
All I could think about was like...
ripping your shirt off with your chest hair flowing.
Uh-huh. Yep.
Beautiful hair through the fucking Florida sun.
Yep.
Saving somebody dying out there.
I know.
Nobody was dying and you had to run an Ironman.
That's so right.
You had to be careful.
So I get out there and I get out to about the point I did that first day, like out to the end of the pier, and it just turned into like the best way they described it was like being in a washer machine, like it just churning.
Like, bro, that sucks.
Bro, it was bad.
That's
like
fucking horrible.
Mentally,
I would be so mentally fucking abused at that point. Mm-hmm. Fucking first leg of the goddamn Ironman, I'd have been like, oh, so I'm gonna fucking swim through this shit.
Yep.
Oh boy, this is gonna be quite the fucking day. That means the wind's blowing as well.
Oh yeah. If you looked straight out off the beach, the waves weren't coming straight in. They were coming in on an angle like this.
So, all right, we know that the water sucked.
Yeah.
Whenever you went through it, because you trained like a fucking savage. Mm-hmm. You did your training, swimming every single fucking morning for months on end here.
Yep.
Which seemed like it.
Yeah.
You got out there. You completed the task. Mm-hmm. How did you feel after the swim?
Yeah, so I got out of the water and I was like relieved. I was like, okay. I was like, what?
Did you feel like you swam 2.4 miles?
No, I felt fresh. I felt like I finally warmed up. Like I was very sore when I started the first lap from the swim on Thursday.
Yeah,
like
from the arching and all the
stupid
shit.
Sore. I'm like, fuck this. I'm either gonna warm up and feel good, or I'm gonna warm up and still feel like shit. So after I got out of the water after the second lap, I looked at my time and I was like 84 minutes, and I'm like, fuck, that's under what I wanted it to do it in.
Yeah.
So that was just a huge confidence boost. And then as soon as I got out of the water, the first person I saw was Kim. Cause like, I don't know why the fucking knee brace, like it just stuck out like all day. So I saw her, I was happy with my time. And I'm like, okay, the rest of the day is on land, which I'm most comfortable with,
like
being a human being,
yeah.
You know,
not a fish.
I was like, and I'm a third way done with my day, even though the time wasn't a third way done. Like one of the three events were done. So then I had like a 0.3, like a quarter mile run from the sand to my bike that was in Pier Park there in Panama City.
So you had to move a quarter mile after you got out of the water in a wetsuit.
Yep.
You had to go a quarter mile to get to your fucking bike.
Yep.
That's like exhausting for me.
I was so scared because
the quarter mile transition.
They told us that before we started for the day, and I'm like, fuck. I'm like barefoot. Like I might, like, what if I step on something bad? Like everything can get fucked up.
Man.
And then they had they usually, I guess, have people that strip your suit off for you. They couldn't have that.
COVID.
So I'm running this whole time trying to get this fucking thing off and trying not to fall and be a dumbass. And then halfway through the run, there was they had like PVC pipe, like showers, to get all the sand off you. Otherwise, you just chafe like a son of a bitch all day.
Salt water, yeah. Sand and shit.
So I washed off best that I could. Wetsuit was off. I was carrying it on my shoulder. Got to my bike, and the goal is to transition as fast as possible. My goal was to be as comfortable as I could getting on the bike out of the gate.
That's probably what I would have. I mentioned this yesterday about the transition times.
Yep.
Because I was watching everything online, and I'm like, yeah, I was like, so I saw your transition time was like 15 minutes. And I'm like, oh, it's pretty good, like 15-minute transition. Like, okay, good. You were solid. You put your fucking – you got all the shit off your body, no salt water, no sand. Good, go on the bike. And I'm like, pretty good fucking transition.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently that's horrible transition.
Oh yeah, it's bad. Yep. It's really bad. 15-minute
transition from the water to the bike. The pros were doing it in 4 minutes.
Yeah, 4 minutes or less.
And I said to myself, as this occurs, I'm like, what happened in the four fucking minutes for these guys that Bob, why, like, the transition has to be part of the training in itself.
Yeah, for sure.
I was like, what did they fucking do in 4 minutes?
They slipped riding shoes on, grabbed their bike, like maybe grabbed water bottle to put on their bike, and then it, and then that probably took 1 minute, and then it took a minute and a half to 2 minutes to run from their bike rack to there's like a line where you have to mount your bike by, and then a mark that you have to be fully on
and moving
and moving by.
So that's whenever we saw you like moving with your bike, like the light jog with your bike.
Yeah.
Saw everybody going around the corner and shit.
Yeah. It was probably like a 10th of a mile you had to go to.
And you weren't allowed to ride your bike.
No.
So that everybody didn't crash and stuff.
Exactly. Yeah. Yep.
So bro, the one guy that won the whole fucking thing, Chris, I was like, dude, transitioned in 4 minutes.
Yeah, dude.
I was like, 4 minutes. I was like, I wanted to know this because I was like, what the fuck did he do mm-hmm. in that 4 minutes that like you did in 15? Because I was like, good, you're solid, you're prepped, you're ready.
Yep.
Go murder the fucking thing. And this dude, I was like, holy fuck, this is wild.
Yeah. Yeah, what I learned is they don't require nearly the amount of like nutrition and hydration that
the pros,
because they're so conditioned. Like, whatever they needed was already on their bike, and they just left.
Well, I noticed this about Ironmen. Mm-hmm. They're tiny people.
They are not large people.
Like, you were a big boy.
I was very large.
You're a large
boy. Not even just my weight, but my height, my size.
The guys, all of them, they're all under 5'8".
For sure.
A lot of guys were under 5'8". Like, majority. You rarely see a large top professional Ironman.
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah. I mean, I'm speaking very generally, but the people that were there, that the pros that were there, were not monsters.
No, by no means. They're
like very efficient, little packed motherfuckers.
Yeah, even seeing like a true just cyclist compared to a triathlete, they're
completely different.
Different look.
Like Shane over here being 5 foot. Shane and I are the same height, 5'6", 5'7". And I'm 225. You're what?
180.
180. They were like 30 pounds less than Shane.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Like efficient, like fucking balls of whatever the fuck an Ironman is.
It was like when we were lined up. When we were lined up for the water, I looked over everyone's head and I'm like, fuck, it looks like a sea of children. Like,
I felt like the fucking asshole.
You felt the awkward giant. Yeah. You're like, oh, look at me, fire.
I was like, oh, I'm in the kids division. Like, what's going on? And
maybe we should go hang out with Iron Man. Yeah,
I'm gonna go big. I'm gonna go to fucking McDonald's.
I'm gonna go get a happy meal
from McDonald's now. Fuck.
I have the fucking the girl doll and the kids meal. Fuck.
Oh, dude.
No, because I became fascinated because for the day we joked, we said it yesterday. My whole day, I did so much on Saturday.
Uh-huh.
I did so much stuff. I fucking worked around the house. I worked at the other house. I did fucking drywall. I fucking watched SJ for 6 hours. Like, it was fucking crazy day.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole time that I accomplished that, at the end of it, it was like 6:30. I'm talking to Nick on the phone doing drywall. And I'm like, man, Bob's still not done.
No, nope.
I was like, I got hours of work here and he's still not fucking done.
Oh, yeah.
It was wild.
Oh, dude, it was, yeah. I didn't even think about the time, to be honest. Like, the time, not at all.
See, because when you left, I was like, because we were talking about like all the different legs of the Ironman.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, your training, what you've done with training, what I watched, I was like, it's... You're going to be just fine because the adrenaline is super intense.
Oh, it's
after
huge.
The swim, I was like, after the swim, you're going to feel like, okay, swim's over, I'm good.
Yeah.
Like, it's not going to be like, because you would swim in the morning, come in and run a whole fucking 10-hour work day.
Yep.
I was like, so, like.
I should be good.
You should be good. Mm-hmm. And then sure enough, that's what occurred.
Yep.
But the one thing that didn't account for it because you train in PA here is the elements of the environment.
Yeah.
The ocean instead of a pool.
Yeah, or a lake. Yeah.
Or a lake. Like the ocean, there's really no comparison to an ocean.
No.
Only thing maybe like Lake Erie, like a fucking great lake.
Yep. Yeah, where it actually has a current and
all that stuff.
Yeah.
But then like also riding the bike.
Yeah, which I had a rude wake-up call with the bike on Wednesday. No, it was Thursday morning. I rode it because up until that Thursday morning, my last time on the road on my bike was the day I crashed my bike.
You fucking had a massive accident.
Yeah, I had a massive accident here in Pittsburgh at North Park. I a lady, just to keep it short, a lady cut me off. She was turning around to meet with her husband.
She was on a bike.
She was on a bicycle. We were in the park, and she turned right in front of me. I was going fast. I was probably doing 20 miles an hour in the aero bars. Couldn't grab the brakes. Tried to go right, and I T-bone her back tire. She's unconscious, split her helmet open. I went up over the bars, skidded to a stop. She was like barely came to. Ambulance took her away. Everything was fine with her, but that was at mile like 53. I was supposed to do 70 that day. Supposed to be my first big long ride on the bike outside, not on a trainer. And that just got cut short by this fucking crash. And it fucked with me hard.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I didn't really talk about it to anyone because the more, like, you talk about it, it's like it just stays with you and it just starts to fuck with you. And I tried to just forget about it. But just because of scheduling, and I didn't want to ride outside again by myself.
No.
And me and Kenny's schedules really never aligned the rest of the prep to get out together.
On a bike.
And I rode the trainer for the rest of the prep, which was like my last 7 weeks or
which
6 weeks.
Which were the big fucking rides.
Which were the 100-mile rides, like 4 weekends in a row. So I did it all on the trainer, which was great. That was a huge benefit to flat Florida. But that morning when I got on my bike to test it, make sure it was good for the weekend, I could barely clip in to the bike and feel comfortable. I could barely go through an intersection going up the interstate and felt comfortable on the bike. I could barely grab a water bottle without feeling shaky on the bike. And I was like, fuck, dude. Like, I went out for a 12-mile ride, 6 miles out, 6 miles back, just to make sure the bike was functioning. And I'm like, I'm supposed to do 112 miles on Saturday, and I don't feel comfortable on my bike.
Holy fuck.
So that, I didn't even say that to Kenny and Kim while I was down there.
Nope.
Like, I got back, and Kim was like, how was it? I was like, great. My speed was great. It was a little windy out there, which it was windy as fuck. A few deer almost ran out on me on the interstate that morning. And I was just like, I was shitting my pants at that point. I'm like, God damn it. I'm like, I know my legs are ready. Like, I've been training my dick off, but now I was like, do I not have enough experience for the road? Like, am I going to be fucked? Am I going to get hurt because of my lack of experience? That was my biggest thing. I was like, I do not want to get hurt again. I do not want to crash again.
You did this in 208 fucking days.
Yeah.
Most people don't do that.
Bro, I rode outside 3 times. 3 times, twice on my first bike that I bought, the road bike,
yeah,
which I hated and hurt my legs and hurt everything on me. The third time being on my new tri bike, crash it the first day I was on the road. And then I tested my tires around the parking lot a week before I left.
Oh, fuck.
That's all I had. And so I did that test ride, freaked me out, but I'm like, Saturday's going to come, and
I mean, I really wish I would have told you not to do this. It would have probably been a better idea.
I feel like a dick now.
I feel like dick not noticing all these things that could have inhibited you from actually completing it, but
right.
Adversity.
So then I got out of the water, took my time, got my bike shoes on, loaded my jersey with all my nutrition, all my shit. I was like, if I have too much on me, I can throw it out.
Yeah.
If not, you know, I got everything with me. So I'm running out of the chute, and Kim and Sayward are right there. So I went over to, like, give Kim a kiss and then get on the road. And I kissed her, and I dropped my bike. Like, fell on its side, like, hard. And, like, these bikes, dude, like,
they're delicate.
Bro, if you bend your derailleur, there goes shifting gears for your whole fucking day. So, like, I tried not to even think about that. I didn't even look at it. I'm like, fuck it. Picked it up. Kept running. Got to the mount line to clip in. Clipped my 1 foot in, and I'm like, whew. I was like, here we go, dude. This is it. Like, there's no looking back. Got going. Got my 2nd foot in, and then I was on the road. And the ride was 112-mile one loop around the Panama City airport, across the interstate, and looped all the way back around.
One lap.
Like, I didn't see anything twice.
Oh,
there was
shit.
No, like, oh, I'm close to transition, I could go back and just call it a day. Like, I was going 56 miles out and
56
miles back. And the first third of the race was the most intense. It was a giant headwinds all morning. Like, I'm talking 20, 25, 30 mile per hour gusts. And this is my first time with race wheels, which are deep dish, yeah, and they just catch all the fucking wind. And this whole time, like, you're fighting for, like, a position, too, because it's everyone's coming out of the gate. Everyone's fired
Everybody
up.
Everybody wants to get moving.
I'm trying to keep my legs calm so I don't burn out right away, fighting this wind. And then what I didn't know is you can't just ride someone's ass on these bikes. Like, you can't draft in an Ironman. It's illegal. Like, you get penalized. You could get pulled to the side and put in a penalty tent. You could get time deducted off your shit. You could get fully DQ'd.
Shane all of a sudden is really interested in
there's
the rules.
There's a fucking penalty tent?
Yeah, there's a penalty tent. Like, they'll make you sit in there for like 15 minutes.
You're getting put in like timeout.
Timeout.
It's almost like the dunce corner.
That's exactly right.
Jesus Christ.
So this whole time,
you're like, man, this guy in front of me is making this really easy.
Well, right. So like you, but the thing is like I'm trying to chill and then people will pass me. So they'll pass and get right in front of me. Well, it's my responsibility to slow up and put that six bike distance.
A six bike distance?
Yeah, that's what's in the athlete guide. Like, you have to have six.
So there's people that are pumping, then get in front of you, and then you have to drift back.
You have to drift back, get back into your pace. So, like, for the first 5 miles, I was trying to figure that out. And I'd go from 17, 18 miles per hour back down to 13, 14.
No shit.
Back and forth, because I wasn't ready to attack like they were.
Fuck no, because it's the first time and you're getting your bike legs under
you. Trying to figure out what my pace is going to be for 6 hours.
So how did you...
How wide can you get on the road?
How wide was the...
So it was
like
different.
Four bikes?
The width that we were riding on?
Yeah.
No, like some parts was just the shoulder of the fucking road, dude. Like shoulder width.
Like one bike.
One bike width. That's all you had. Otherwise, you were riding over that white solid line in a lane of traffic. And, you know, some of the more dangerous intersections and roads, they were closed, which was fine. But then once you're about 20 miles away from the beach, dude, they can't shut down an interstate. Like Interstate 79, 388, they're the main roads in and out of the airport.
Holy fuck.
Yeah, dude. Like, I didn't know what to expect. We got to a point that we were on these like backcountry roads, like dotted lines, but two-way traffic.
Yeah.
And it was a turnaround point. So like we had to go down and then we had to turn around to come back. So we have both shoulders
and two lanes of traffic.
And two lanes of traffic. Like, big diesel trucks, like it's Florida, it's all trucks down there splitting the
double, like Florida Georgia line with,
it's exactly like that.
Yeah,
just
like fruitcakes and Fords with big wheels and small tires.
Yeah,
that was a thing.
The wheel tire, the wheel to tire ratio was off.
Yeah, I don't like it.
I don't like it either.
I like a big tire and a smaller
Savior.
Wheel. I'm Florida Georgia people. I don't get them.
So we were,
Shane, you say something derogatory to Florida Georgia people.
Oh, man, that put me on the spot.
Yeah, it was perfect time for them to hate you for another reason.
I know, Jesus Christ. What sucks
in
Florida?
Because I was hoping
that
they hate me less and hate you more for me making fun of them.
All right.
Say, fuck you guys.
Fuck you guys, pussies.
That worked. They're offended. So I was just learning that the whole way, fighting traffic. Like, it was intense, dude. That first half of the ride was really intense till I figured out my pace, till I got away from the wind.
So, were there people crashing?
Yeah, I saw a guy crash right in front of me. He got cut off, like gripped his brakes, went up and over.
No shit.
Oh, yeah. And then throughout the day, saw flat tires, saw guys road rashed all the way up their right sides. Because the second half of the race, we were on a different interstate that had... Like, it wasn't smooth. Like, it was rumbly, and then they had rumble strips on the side. So, like...
You're riding that small-ass fucking tire over rumble strips?
It eventually got to the point that I no longer was riding the shoulder. I rode to the left of the rumble strips on the white solid line because it was the smoothest piece of the road. Like,
get the fuck
you
out
were,
of here.
You were straddling a line like that for fucking
that
miles.
That fucking four-inch line.
Yep. So, I rode that
three and a half, whatever the fuck it is.
I hit my halfway point. which was my special needs area. I got another bag, had three new bottles for me. I had a frozen cooler in there that had like a Milky Way and Uncrustables and like just things that like I wasn't really in the mood to eat them, but like I took a bite of each and it just made you happy almost. Mm-hmm. And then the second half, I really started to turn it on and like there was some slight grades like going downhill. Like you didn't even know. But I started to pick up like 22, 23, 24 miles per hour.
Because I watched your time on the bike, and I was like, it's pretty consistent with what you were doing. But whenever we're watching as people, everybody should know this as well, you were the fourth most tracked athlete at the Ironman.
Yeah, dude. It was pretty
So, because that Chris, the kid that had Down syndrome, was number one. Mm-hmm. Like on the Ironman tracker, it could track who's watching and who's paying attention and how many, the number of people. He was number one with like, what, like
26,000?
Yeah, like 25,000 plus people were tracking him on that tracker. Mm-hmm. And Bob was number four.
How many people?
It's like 1,100, just about.
So all of us, you're welcome.
Yeah. Oh yeah, for sure. Bro, the amount of support that our Axe and Sledge customers and demo crew and everyone in between.
It's awesome.
Like literally, you guys made me the number four most tracked person in this entire event over pros that were doing this.
The guy that won was number five.
Yeah, he was right behind me.
The guy that took fucking number one at the whole goddamn Ironman.
Yep.
He was in fifth place on being the most tracked person there.
Yep.
And like looking at it as anybody that pays attention to numbers, you guys fucking know. Mm-hmm. But whenever like he looked into it, probably he's probably like, who the fuck?
Who is this guy?
So does that mean that Bob won the Ironman? I think so.
Bob took fourth at the Ironman.
Well, I started getting hit up by like a bunch of companies because of that. Like Boar's Head Meats, they reached out to me, offered me a whole deal. Vaseline reached out to me. You know, my chafe sponsor. You know, so that it was.
I tried to use the Beat My Meat code. It didn't fucking work.
Where'd you try to use it at?
The internet.
Oh yeah, it's not internet based. It's an in-person coupon code.
In-person coupon you have to tell them. The grocery stores.
Yeah, I used it last night at Giant Eagle. It went over fine. Beat My Meat 20
for 20% off of Boar's Head Meats.
Yeah, use it wherever you go worldwide. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just not on the internet.
Nope. Bro, you did that. I'm fucking dying. I'm losing it. I'm like, you're fucking dead serious, fucking straight face.
Well, it was.
And then Hannah's like, she's like, what's the sponsorship? What's the deal? And I'm like, it's a fucking joke, dude. And she's like, no, like, is he really sponsored by Boar's Head? And I'm like, his code says beat my fucking meat.
Yeah.
It says beat my meat.
20.
20. Yeah. Nobody's giving the fucking discount. It's like, what are you going to do? Go to the fucking Delello's and be like, beat my meat 20 for 20% off.
Dude, that was that we were joking all week about that. It was like one of those it was Kenny. Like Kenny has like these like comic relief, because like he saw I was in a rough spot all week, like emotionally, and he was doing these things all week to fuck with me. Like across from our hotel was a deli, like breakfast sandwiches and big Boar's Head Meat sign. I was like, I love Boar's Head Meats. And he's like, you're a big cased meat guy. I'm like, well, so is Shane. I was like, Shane loves hot dogs and
likes Jimmy John's
pickles. And we got on that whole deli talk. And then we were joking all week. I was like, yeah, I'm doing a seminar at Boar's Head Meats across the street this week for everyone. And it just went on from there. Jeez. But it was all week fucking Kenny's fucking with me. Like, right to the borderline of like me being upset about it, but it also like kind of helping me out. Like race morning before I had to be down there in like 15 minutes and he's putting my numbers on my arm and the back of my leg. And my age goes on my left calf. Well, he put the 3 on backwards. And we had another 3, but these things are made to not fucking come off. 'Cause
you sweat like, all day.
Yeah. We had no rubbing alcohol, no fucking nail polish remover to take it off. He's scrubbing my leg with a fucking Brillo pad.
Oh!
Like, and he's like, does that hurt? I'm like, no, yeah, it's fine. And I'm like, fuck, yeah. It's like, I'm burnt from the week. And he's playing it cool. I'm trying to like, okay. Like,
I want to punch you in the face, but I'm not going to because I love
like,
you.
He's like, we're going to be fine, dude. I'm like, okay, yeah. I was like, just fucking put it on there. So then like, like there's other things. Like he put this fucking plunger like in the middle of my closet, like right in the middle of the floor. Like I couldn't get my bike out because of this fucking plunger. I'm like, who the fuck put this here? Like I was gonna bring it up to Kim later. Like I thought maybe she needed to use it in the bathroom, and
it was like hiding.
I wanted to do it in private, not blow her up like in front of everyone there. So I moved it, and he's like, let's get your bike, go over your bike quick. And my God, he's like, what's that? He's like, what's with the plunger like in the closet here? And I was like, I don't know. That's a good question. I don't know. And he's like laughing. I was like, are you fucking with me right now, dude? And he was, and it was all fucking weak. Like the worst timing, yet probably the best timing looking back on it now.
Kenny is, he's pretty good at doing that.
He's very good at doing that.
The story you told yesterday was pretty funny, like during the bike ride, because of him coming to see you. Like whenever you were about halfway through, and Scott come out of nowhere.
Dude, mile 20. I kind of expected to see them because they were talking about their plan. But mile 20, I turned through this bad intersection. The cops have traffic stopped in both directions. And fucking Kenny and Scott are running down the road as I'm turning in. Like I barely even saw them. And I'm like, holy fuck, that's Kenny and Scott. They drove they had a Rubicon for their rental car. They drove like across the median, parked it just to like the cops did not want them where they were at. They were like looking at them like, these are the only fucks not obeying what we're doing here. And they're sprinting with me on the bike, filming me like, hey, are you okay? How are you feeling? And I'm like, I'm good. I was like, I'm fine. I'm like, what the fuck?
The cops are telling you not to fucking do this. Kenny be like, no worries, we're good.
Bro, it was miles in each direction, stop traffic, and then here's these fucking guys parked on the side of the road.
I could see Kenny, like the cops yelling at him and giving him a ton of shit.
Oh, yeah.
And then I could see Kenny going back. Like, he'd be like, don't worry, hold on, I'll be right back. I'm going to help him.
Yep.
No big deal. I can park here. No, you fucking can't. I just told you not to park there. Kenny comes back. Cop's like, what the fuck? And he's like, hey, dude, you look great. Do you work out?
Yeah, right. What do you bench press, dude? Yes.
You look really healthy, man. You're like your jawline. You got a strong jawline. You just start complimenting the guy right away. And he's like, yeah, I do work out.
Like, are you one of the fittest, like, cops in Panama City? Like,
actually, I am. I'm really big around here. I work out. I give everybody advice. You should do an Ironman. Let me tell you about it.
That's exactly how
things. I've never swam in the water yet. It's really nice. You want to go for a swim later? Here's my number.
Yeah.
Here's my number. Call me anytime you want to go for a swim. I'm here all week. By the end of it, the cop will be like, man, I'm really sorry for telling you couldn't park there.
Yeah.
You can park anywhere you want, Panama. Say, gives you a problem, call me. I'll take care of it.
That's exactly how he does things, dude.
Kenny.
It is, to a T. He's just, he is something else. He really
is. Fucking riot. And the thing is, it's like, because he's got that infectious shit.
He does, man. He even like when you feel like it's not like the right time, like he sees it in you. Like even just when he pops into, like, you know, he works for ADPs and all these offices, sees all these people.
That's all he does, is deal with people.
Like
people and problems.
Like he'll see you having a bad day, and somehow his way of doing things, which would normally, if it was anyone else, would frustrate me, or I'd be like, all right, dude, like I'm having a day.
Shit.
Yeah, there's just none of that, you know. And then
Kenny running through. It's bro, okay. Running. I can park there. No, you fucking can't.
Yep. But it was. I tell you what. Seeing them in that moment, because it was the first 20 miles, like by myself, silent. It was everything I needed to see, like to just keep me going for the rest of the bike ride.
Fuck yeah.
So yeah, the second half of the bike. I was pretty fast, and I got comfortable. Like by the end, I felt like I had the time on the road that I should have had going into it. And the last 15 miles, I felt really fucking strong. Like I finished them really strong. And coming into the run, I saw Kenny and Scott again. They met me at like mile 105 or so. And I was coming in like stretching on the bike, because that's kind of what you're supposed to do the last 12 miles, and make sure you're stretched out, getting ready for the run. And I skipped the last aid station at mile 100 because I was like, oh, I only got 12 more to do. And I think that may have been one of my biggest problems with cramping later in the run.
Oh, yeah.
Was skipping that aid station.
No shit.
Because I would have got another fresh water. I would have ate more. I would have taken another salt tab. And I skipped all that because I'm like, I feel great. My legs are strong. Let's just get to my fucking running shoes and get on the road. I should have stopped there.
So you went from there. Mm-hmm. We'll fast forward a bit.
Yep.
You went from there. You transitioned again.
Yep.
A little longer of a transition than the pros.
Yep.
Maybe you should start training that up. Just a piece of advice from an Ironman watcher.
I could shave 25 minutes pretty quick. Yep.
But so you get on the road, and how did you feel after the bike?
Yeah.
Because, again, you felt fresh after the swim.
Yeah.
Pretty good. You're like, fuck yeah, I'm ready for the bike. Mm-hmm. How'd you feel after the bike?
Oddly enough, I felt pretty fresh. Like, my legs felt good. They were full, like, just, like, you could see all my veins. They were full of blood. But, like, mostly the rear of your legs. Like, you really pull with your glutes and your hamstrings
and your calves.
So I got off, put my running shoes on. I'm like, I feel as good as I could right now after riding 112
so
miles.
So after you get off the bike and then you transition into running, you don't obviously, you like finishing the bike ride, mm-hmm. do you like stroke, or is that like a pedal? Is that like a stroke or a pedal, or how's that different?
Pedal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like the distance, how it is, rather than like, you know, whenever you take like long strides running or long strides walking,
mm-hmm.
The transition, like, you can't just probably start running out of the gate. You're like, because for 112 miles, you're in one motion, and now you're switching to a new motion.
Yeah.
It's not the same. So how did the pace go from the bike to the run?
Yeah, so Scott wanted me to do like a 10:30 to 11-minute pace out of the gate for the first—
On the run.
Yeah, on the run for the first 3 to 4 miles. Just for everything to like loosen up in your legs and that blood to redistribute, your quads start to fire like a lot stronger than your hamstrings do. And my goal was to keep that for like 4 miles, then come down to that low 10 pace till mile 8. And then at mile 8, that's kind of like where you're like, okay, how do I feel? Do I open it up? Do I stay at this pace? And I was being cautious with that pace. So like at mile 8, I kept that like 9:45 to 10:30.
Yeah.
I was staying at that because I would go down 6.5 miles, 6.5 miles back, 6.5 back out, and then 6.5 back to close it out.
Yeah.
So I got down, made the turn, hit mile 8, and I'm like, I feel fucking great. I was like, I'm still going to, at this point, like a 10.5 minute pace, like I'm shuffling, I'm not striding out, like it's not long strides, like it's, you're shuffling your feet. And I was getting closer to the next turnaround point to head back down, so halfway point, mile 13, and I was like, I still feel really fucking good. Like along that whole way, I'm eating the gels, I'm getting some hydration at the aid stations, like water, and they had Gatorade Endurance there. And then about mile 15, after I made the turn, mile 16, I like started to feel like crampy in my inside of my right leg. And I'm like, fuck. I'm like, I slowed it down a little bit just to make sure to milk that. Then by mile 17, mile 18, I was like, fuck. And then mile like 18.5, 19, it fucking hit hard. Like it stopped me. I couldn't even walk. So I'm like, fuck, dude. Like, and I'm thinking, I'm like, I feel so good right now. Like mentally, I'm not like disoriented. Like I feel like I'm hydrated, but I obviously wasn't. And I'm just standing there like rubbing it out with my forearm. I just wanted to get walking again.
Well, I don't know if I'd say that it was your hydration or anything like that. It could have just been maybe muscle fatigue.
Maybe fatigue.
From like 130 miles previous to that.
Right.
I don't know. Just maybe guessing that. Because at this point, it's one of those things that you've never done this before.
No.
You ran marathons on the weekend like as practice. You'd run like 25 miles on a Friday.
Yeah. I ran, my longest was 22 miles. And I ran that like fresh at the beginning of the day, not doing anything else that day. Yeah.
So, but regardless, mm-hmm. when you do bike 110 the next day or whatever the fuck you were doing, 105.
Yeah.
So the cramping might not have been just from...
The other variable, whether that was the reason or not, is we were running on the shoulder of the road on the main street in Panama City, and like the road's flat, but then the shoulder like slopes in.
Oh yeah, for it water runoff.
So like when I made that turn, and like you said, I was just fatigued. Like I was a little, like I wasn't running on flat.
Oh, cattywampus.
Yeah, it was like kind of like leaning to the right, and that's where it started to flare up. So I ended up walking like a mile and a half to the next aid station. I had two like salt tabs left. I took those. I ate through the whole run. I ate like four or five bananas, which like made me feel awful.
That's disgusting.
And if I don't see another banana for a few months, I'll be okay with it. But I got that in me. The Gatorade Endurance is loaded with sodium and carbohydrates, so I was drinking that. And then I just kept walking for like another half mile because I didn't want it to trigger it so bad that I was just, I couldn't even walk anymore.
But then you ended up picking it up.
Yeah, so I ended up like jogging again, and I guess Kenny and Scott were watching my times dip on the tracker, and they met up with me. They drove down and then ran a mile up to like mile almost 19, 20 and found me. And they saw that I was running. They're like, oh, you are running. Like, you're not, like, down and out. I'm like, I was, like, a mile ago.
I was back there.
So they started running with me. I was running, like, a 12-minute mile pace. And Scott slowed me down. Like, he started his watch and got me at, like, a 13:30. And he's like, dude, he's like, you have to just cruise this the rest of the way in. He's like, you have to just cruise that.
In order to make it and succeed at this Ironman, you have to cruise in this way.
And it was like a shuffle. Like, I was just dragging my fucking feet a little bit.
It was like me running.
Like, you're like your full run.
Like my run. Because whenever he came, when he was videotaping you, I saw on the stories.
Yeah.
And Kenny was like singing or some shit behind you and talking you up, telling you this shit.
Yep.
And I'm like, oh man, it's like that's not bad.
Yeah.
It's like that's how I would probably run. Period.
Anything.
So I was pumped. I was like, he's good. We're good. But you ended up. You ended up finishing at what? 15.
Yeah, 14:26 was my actual like official time, I think.
14:26.
Yeah, the tracker was showing 14:06, but it's just off from the official tracker. So that I cruised in. They actually helped someone that passed out right after they set my pace for me. Like there was someone on the side of the road, and they went right over to him. They're like, "Bro, just go." So they were helping him.
Holy fuck.
Yeah, dude, dude was out. Like, he was in the gutter of the fucking road, just,
God.
Yeah, it was rough to see. I saw that several times on the
run. Get the fuck out of here.
Oh, yeah, dude. Bro, it's fucking nuts out there.
So, here's the thing I gotta say. So, you finished a race at 14:26,
mm-hmm.
ran through Robert Dautrich.
Dautrich. From
Avon Moore.
Avon Moore. You're it's because I'm Dutch.
Yeah. What a DJ.
They knew my Dutch roots.
They knew you were from fucking Pennsylvania Dutch, you douchebag. So finish all that.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody doesn't complete this.
No.
A lot of people don't complete this.
Yeah.
Like hundreds of people at a race don't complete this.
Mm-hmm.
The dude that was passed out in the gutter, there was nobody around to take care of him.
No.
It's like, again, there's Kenny at the right place at the right time saving people's lives.
Yep.
Like, this is something that we're talking about, all the training that you've done and all the great things and laughing about it and you eating fucking 17 goddamn bananas and all this and Gatorade Endurance tasting as good as it does and your Boar's Head meat sponsorship and Vaseline reaching out to you. Like, all these great fucking spectacular things that are happening.
Mm-hmm.
There are people that do not complete it at all.
Yeah, yeah.
There are people that didn't put the training in.
Mm-hmm.
There are people that fucking had road rash, bandaged up, had to back out, blown out tires multiple times. Like, there are things in which could have gone wrong and fucked everything up.
Yep.
It's not something that is supposed to be taken lightly. What I think that most people, I mean, a lot of people were inspired. I got like 500 messages from people.
Yeah.
And I couldn't imagine what yours looked like.
Dude, it's insane.
Most fourth tracked Ironman at this race.
Yeah.
But, this isn't for the faint of heart.
No.
This isn't for, like, even for as much of fuck-offs as we are on this podcast sometimes and joke around, if people are wanting to do something like this, don't be like the dude that's in the ditch.
No.
Pay attention. Like, there are people that finished ahead of you. Mm-hmm. There are people, the pro Ironmen, that this is all they do for everything that they do. Mm-hmm. You have to be dedicated to something like this.
Yeah.
You can't just go in and be like, hey, there's people that run, you know, there's people that run 10K and they're like really good. Mm-hmm. People that can run 10 miles. Mm-hmm. And then they're like, I'm going to jump into a fucking marathon. This isn't something that you just jump into, even though you kind of did.
Yeah.
But the training and the sacrifice that's involved with doing an Ironman, this is dangerous. Mm-hmm. Like, we started out with you in the fucking ocean.
Yeah.
Like, the wide open water. Mm-hmm. And you're from Western PA swimming at the YMCA in 25-yard pool.
Yeah, 20.
20-yard pool. I'm not allowed to push off the wall when I get there. How far is 20 yards?
Like,
60 feet.
Yeah.
Wait, what?
It's like nothing.
That
yeah.
sucks.
Yeah. Do thousands of laps to get.
So then you did that in order to train for an Ironman that's mm-hmm. in the fucking ocean.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I saw people saying, we should do something like that in the demo crew. We should do this and that. And I'm like, hey, guys, like, why don't we start with like a 5K?
Yeah.
Let's all get together and do 5K. Yeah. I'll watch.
Yep.
I'll bring the snacks. I'll provide all the snacks and drinks.
Yeah.
But it's this accomplishment is something that very few people do. Mm-hmm. It is super intense, and it is not to be taken lightly in any way, shape, or form.
No, I mean, you could be the most ready person out there, physically, mentally, and your bike malfunctions, you're off with your nutrition, you start cramping up. Like, you could be literally the most in shape person out there and have the worst day and not complete it.
Wow.
So like I had a thought in my head. I wanted to do it in less time. I did. I wanted to hit that 12 to 13 and a half hour mark.
Yeah.
And I learned so quick that I could try to do that and probably fail because I literally just didn't have, I had 200 days. I had 16 weeks of actual prep to get ready for that. I was like, or I can kind of baby everything a little bit, turn it
That's
on
a
when,
bad
I,
term
when
to use. I don't like that.
Not baby it, but I
no,
guess be a, like disciplined,
yes.
more disciplined with my paces. And
yes.
if anything was faster than what it was, it would have been questionable if I would have fully got through that finish line.
I'm not going to dig on you here. But 208 days ago, you weren't the most healthy person.
No.
So I think this and what it is and just completing an Ironman is something that very few people ever do.
Mm-hmm.
And I think more training, like years, like most people do.
Yeah.
And maybe doing a distance swim, maybe like being on the bike more than three times.
Maybe run a marathon one time.
Maybe run a marathon or two.
Yeah.
That might be something good, or just get some experience on the road mm-hmm. with a bike and all these things. There are so many indicating factors that come into play with all of this.
Yeah.
And the whole experience factor that play a huge role, mm-hmm. you know, and that's something that you're like, oh, well, I wanted to hit this marker. And it's like, yeah, you will. It's just going to take this type of time.
Yep.
Because not digging on you, Bob.
Mm-hmm.
You were never a big-time athlete.
No.
You weren't like a high school fucking phenom. Mm-mm. You weren't nothing like it.
Nope.
You were just fucking Stoner Bob.
Yep.
Stoner Bob is an Iron Man.
Mm-hmm.
That's fucking wild.
It
because
is.
Because anybody that's listening to this right now and all the people that tracked you, everybody that has never done anything physically insane is like, maybe I could do it. And the answer is... Yeah.
Yeah.
You guys watched, anybody that's been watching and paying attention to everything we do, you watched someone go from Stoner Bob, drinking bourbon, eating too many snacks and being undisciplined,
mm-hmm.
255 pounds, which was pretty in shape from your 285 pounds,
yep.
to 195 pounds of fucking intense Iron Man.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you watched it happen. That means you can do it.
Yeah.
Bob was never an athlete. You weren't fucking D1. You weren't D2. You were fucking selling half a pound with the brothers down in Reading.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, that was you.
That was, yeah.
Yeah, smoking blunts and eating Taco Bell.
Uh-huh.
Sounds like JUCO.
Like, bro, this is something that most people can't even conceptualize themselves doing.
Yeah.
You saw it occur. You saw it occur at the age of 31 years old.
Mm-hmm.
You saw the opportunity to do it. Most people do things like this at a younger age. Mm-hmm. Some people are like, oh, I'm 35 years old. I'm past being able to do something great. No, you're not.
Nope.
There was a ton of people in that Ironman over the age of 40.
Oh, my God. The largest age group was 55 to 60.
Get the fuck out of
here. Had 200 and some entries. Like, my age group had, I think, 95. And then, like, that showed up was, like, 88. The 55 to 60 was the largest age group. Like, the majority were over 45.
Get the fuck out.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Dude. Guys just fuck and, like, ripping it. Like, flying by me. Like, some of the dudes that I, like, ran by me, like, lapped me during the run. And I'm like, I started it with you guys, and you guys lapped me.
Oh.
Yeah. 45, 50, 55. The one lady I rode with the whole day, pretty much saw her, like, back and forth. She was 60 years old.
Get the fuck out
of
here.
Bro, in fucking shape. Looked like a triathlete. Cap shoulders, fucking crazy huge calves. Strong bike rider, obviously.
Yeah.
And
yeah, fucking animal.
60 years old. It was on the back of her calf. I'm like, holy fuck, dude. I was like, I got to finish this fucking thing. I got to.
Well, yeah.
You know, and I contribute it to, like, I had X amount of workouts per week for 16 weeks, an actual dialed in plan for 16 weeks. I missed 3 workouts in 16 weeks. You can't miss workouts training for something like this.
No.
You can't miss workouts training to become a professional bodybuilder. You can't miss a workout to do anything of any magnitude like this. And if you think you can, and you're like, I'll make it up here, I'll do this here, I'll do this faster, I'll eat more. No, it does not work like that. And if you say, well, life got in the way here and I had to do this, well, no. I put my wife and my family second, and I trained first and tried to make it better second.
That's tough to say.
And it's very tough to say, and it's something I did every day.
Yes.
For 16 weeks.
Yes.
I put things on the back burner here at work consistently for 16 weeks. I put things on the back burner with Kim every single fucking day mm-hmm. for 16 weeks. She did not like me most of that time. I didn't really like me at certain times of it.
So what do you say this? So now we're here. We're yep. through the race, everything, and you're looking back at it all. Those are tough things to say.
Mm-hmm.
They're difficult because they're typically with the people you love.
Mm-hmm.
So the question would be is why then?
Why did I do
if
it?
If you knew,
yeah.
if you know these things are occurring, is that like so... Are you an asshole for wanting to do it? Or, I guess, are you an asshole for wanting to do it? Or are you great for actually completing it?
Right.
Because that's the ultimate question in mm-hmm. life.
Yeah, I mean, it's a phenomenal thing personally, like a personal achievement for me. Like, I'll never be able to say like I would have changed anything or done it differently because I wouldn't have had the same result. So from that aspect, I'm very proud of completing it and having that behind me. But the reason for that didn't start, like it started like that in the beginning. I was like, oh, I want to do this for me. You know, I said to you, I always admired you becoming a pro bodybuilder with all the things that you went through with your life during that time and what I saw with you building these businesses. And the moment I saw a glimpse of like me having such big improvements with my training, that's what just got me so engulfed and hooked into it. I'm like, I've been trying to become like this bodybuilder for years and not seeing any progress other than just looking thicker and fatter and not ever getting anywhere to seeing serious progress to coaches that don't bullshit me saying, hey dude, you have a really good shot at like doing something big with like, this training.
You're pretty fucking good at this.
Yeah. And I could not step away from there being an opportunity that I never had when I was in high school. I never had that like, oh man, everyone's coming out to see my basketball game Friday night. They're coming out to do this, even though I had all the support in the world
everybody
with whatever
you.
I did.
Yeah, everybody loved you, but you still didn't like feel
I
it.
I never had that feeling in here. And as I was going through everything and seeing people making a very similar choice with like how they worked out, or they knew they weren't ever going to become this great bodybuilder, but they're like, fuck, I'm pretty good at running. And since I've been running, I look better and I feel better. And inspiring all these people, that's what drove me to finish this prep. Because, dude, I was going to quit the week that Kim had her knee surgery. I was going to bag it. I was going to bag it all. She was going through all that shit. I had to immediately take over things at the house. It kept me away from work for 10 days, which was a fucking disaster. And I was like, I'm quitting right now. And she got behind me. Everyone else got behind me. And so my why turned into like,
I can't not do it.
I can't not do it. Everyone else would be like, fuck, I can just quit then too. It's okay.
So that's where that hard thing where I said, are you an asshole for being selfish, mm-hmm. or are you great for actually following through with it? There's a fine line. And that's what makes your support system and the people that love you so important within this whole thing.
Yep.
Because they won't let you quit. Mm-hmm. Because you are going after something great. You are going after something incredible. Mm-hmm. And to be honest, they want to be a part of it.
Yep.
Because it is incredible. Mm-hmm. And those are the things, but during that time, in those situations, you don't know the answer. Mm-mm. That's what makes the end result so great,
yep.
is the process that you go through in order to succeed at a goal. Mm-hmm. And quitting is something that's very common and very easy to do,
yeah.
but also very difficult, mm-hmm. because there are certain things that could inhibit, you know, this process. However, like, the perseverance, your team, the support, the love, all that comes into play. Yep. And the same thing goes on in bodybuilding. The same thing goes on in building businesses. It goes on at fucking being a high-end athlete, whether it's basketball, football, you fucking name it. Mm-hmm. These things go on behind closed doors. Because, again, what we all started with this was everybody just sees the fluff.
Yep.
Everybody just shows the good. Nobody sees the intense fucking questions that have to be answered, mm-hmm. or the problems that arise. Nobody shows that. Mm-mm. We talk about it here.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, fuck, Rich Piana was one of the first guys to talk about steroids online, mm-hmm. on the internet.
Yeah.
I came pretty strong up behind him there after he passed away, and I was like, all right, let's do steroids, drugs, and life videos.
Yep.
Got phone calls. Hey, you guys shouldn't fucking do this. I'm like, fuck you. You don't write my paycheck. Yep. Nobody's writing my fucking paycheck. Until you pay me, shut the fuck up. Mm-hmm. So along the way, you're going to have all these different adverse things that occur, and you have to have an answer, and that answer could be good or bad.
Yeah.
And you're going to have to live with the consequences.
Yeah, like the – I mean, Kim and I have been together almost 17 years. I mean, I'm thinking that had something to do with her, like, not leaving me during this prep.
Probably.
You know, so, like, the way, even though I did handle things delicately with her and I wasn't a complete dickhead all the time, the amount of time I put into it is clearly enough to ruin a relationship or to ruin something personally with your loved ones.
Oh, I can fuck it up pretty good.
You know? And it just,
I would say that's why most big time celebrities, businessmen, anybody of a high demanding position at anything, mm-hmm. has relationship troubles.
Yeah.
The majority of them stem from work, that work being work or being an athlete. Mm-hmm. Like everybody that's, you know, a big time professional athlete, they're like, yeah, he's a fucking douchebag, left his wife and kids and all this shit. It's like, well, you watch him every Sunday. You think he just plays football one day a week? Mm-hmm. Right. You think he plays football just on Sundays? You don't think that he does 27 other things throughout the fucking week where he is one of the best quarterbacks in the world?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, this is fucking intense shit. Mm-hmm. And it's those relationships. Somebody that owns a business, like Hannah loves me a lot. A lot.
Yep.
Kind of a fucking prick. I'm a little emotionless, uh-huh. at times. But those are the things that if you, it's a give and take with everything. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't have all of the fucking evening and weekend time that people that work a more steady 8 to 10 hour day a job.
Yeah.
I don't have that. Mm-hmm. I get time in the morning, and then like last night, I fell asleep. I don't even remember falling asleep. I was in bed. I woke up this morning at 6 o'clock, And I'm like, I didn't fucking wake up for SJ in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
All right. Right. So I did fucking sleep for about 5.5 hours.
Uh-huh.
So I'm pumped.
Yep.
And I get up and I'm like, all right, I'm going to do the same thing I did yesterday. I'm like, good God. Yep. It's what we all do, but it's they're 12, 14, 16 hour days.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't watch television shows. I don't know anything about them.
Yep.
And that does tax your relationship. We own fucking 5 different businesses. She's part owner of fucking gymnastics. Like, her life's intense too. 3 fucking kids.
Yep.
Owner of a business. Run the motherfucker. It's nuts.
Yeah, I mean, I think that important thing is, like, when you do have that time and when you do spend that time, it's like you're fully in that those little.
And I imagine this is going on at your home. Just slow down.
Yeah.
Maybe like 5:15, like I said at the beginning.
Yeah.
Because Hannah's like, maybe a vacation soon?
Yeah.
Maybe like 3 days?
I know.
Can I get your undivided attention? Can I throw your phone in the water?
Yep.
Like, we won't see it for 3 days.
I know.
I'm fucking cool with it. Let's go.
I know. I'm trying to figure it out.
Oh, yeah. You're fucked.
Yeah.
Like, right now, all of us here, it's Black Friday.
Yeah.
Like, Black Friday's fucking mayhem. We're getting ready. We're moving AAR here, all this shit.
Yep.
And it's kind of like, yeah, like, I'd like to slow down, but that's not going to happen. You just got done training for an Ironman, swimming every goddamn morning, biking 100 miles, all this shit. And it's like, hey, I'd like you to just stop.
How?
Can you tell me the part where you're teaching me how not to do this now?
Yeah. How am I okay with not working out for like 2 weeks?
Yeah.
Like, hey, you don't do anything for 2 weeks.
I'm gonna mentally fuck you right now.
Can I lift weights? No.
No, that's no. Bad. Don't do that.
Can I run?
You can play Call of Duty. Comes out tomorrow.
Does it really?
Yeah.
The new one, yeah.
Oh, that'll make Kim real happy.
I'll talk to her today. She'll be fine.
Yeah.
She'll be fine.
Oh,
no, but
God.
It's, Bud, I have to say that inspired me, dude. I had goosebumps all weekend.
Yeah.
Seeing everybody, how excited everybody are. It is one hell of an accomplishment. I know that I never knew.
I didn't either, man.
I never
knew. I didn't either.
So the question is, we'll end it and then we'll get into some more fuckery.
Yeah.
Did anybody shit their pants along the way? Did you see anybody like shit themselves? Because you see like people doing the 100-mile yeah. races and like David Goggins is like, I shit myself. And
yeah.
you're like, good God, you shit yourself. Did you know anybody that shit yourself or have any wet farts or
no.
curiosity about them bananas or anything like
Bro,
it?
Bro, my GI was on point that day. Like I was good. I didn't visually see any shits.
Nobody shits.
I'm sure many did. I didn't see any. You know, you're all tight and spandexed in there.
I didn't know if like somebody probably if I don't know if it was like a running win or it'd be more thick.
I saw
anybody
a bunch of
loading their pants.
I saw a bunch of people throwing up throughout the day,
oh,
like
yeah?
right in front of you, like just
blah,
keep going.
Nice. Fucking,
yeah, I saw
Iron
that
Man
a bunch
shit.
Of time. I saw the clenched ass to porta potty walk.
Oh
like,
yeah, the
like,
water.
Oh, oh, oh. I didn't see any shits like actual live, which I'm thankful of. I do have a funny story. The Wednesday night, we got ice cream, and I had an Iron Man shirt on. I already had this shit on, and this dude was walking by. He obviously has done more than one Iron Man, and he saw me eating ice cream, and he's like, hey, he's like, be fucking careful with ice cream. He's like, I had bad experiences with ice cream and running races. He's like, after today, no ice cream, dude. And I'm like, yeah, I'll be fine. And Kenny's like, yeah. He's like, we'll be fine, dude. And after that, all I could think, I was like, fuck. I was like, will this be out of my stomach by Saturday? I was like, am I going to shit? Am I going to shit from this fucking ice cream? So I had no, like, I didn't really have anything. I had Kim baked cookies halfway through the week. I had them then. But then, like, 36 hours out, dude, I just had proteins and like rice and pasta and really clean shit. Cause
oh
all I could think about was like, if I shit myself on that bike, all I'm gonna think about is that guy fucking.
And you're like, a
I couldn't
freak.
Even,
you're
I couldn't
like
even
a,
enjoy
you're a clean
it.
Freak. Me, oh. I've shit in bags before on job sites. I fucking took dumps in closets in a bucket. Like, you name it, like plastering and drywalling and fucking construction. It's just ugly shit in the woods.
Yep.
You name it.
Yeah,
me, if that would have happened to me, and I'm like, I'd have been like, all right. So I, from bodybuilding, everybody's seen me fucking naked, tiny dick hanging out, the whole nine, balls shriveled up into you, freezing your fucking nuts off, drying all the fucking, all the spray tan on you.
Yep.
And I'm like, if this would have happened to me, like if I'd have had the shit, like in the middle of it, I probably would have just jumped over the railing, dropped the drawers and fucking took a big dump and hopped back up and been fine. Yep. Like, I'm just disgusting like that.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's most people are like that, but I'd have been like, fuck it.
I would have been, it would have fucked me over.
I know it would have like, fucked
I,
you
I may have backed
you're
out.
You're super, super clean.
I am.
I'm a little disgusting. A little fucking, a little bit of a pig.
Oh my God.
I have a question.
Yeah.
What's that?
Would you do it again?
Yeah, that's that's the next question.
For sure.
You're going to do 100%. Would you do another one?
100%.
Yeah. Are you, the goals now are pretty much, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
Just training a little bit more?
Yeah, I'm actually
maybe run a marathon or two.
Yeah, I'm going to meet with Scott and Kenny this weekend and talk about next year, cuz like the tough thing is like you have to commit to races now for next year because they fill up as soon as registrations open, they fill up in 3 days for 12 months from now.
Oh no shit.
So like realistically, if I wanted to do a full, there's only like 3 to end the year. So it'd have to be end of the year, and I don't want to do another end of the year race. It got too much in the way of with what we do as a business and as a company. It's our busiest fucking time of the year. I want, if I do another one, I want to be able to make huge improvements.
I was just going to say, there's probably different techniques to train for big improvements on certain things.
Yeah, like one of the big things Scott was excited for, he's like, you have so much endurance and speed coming out of it. He's like, let's try to do like a marathon in February or March. And he's like, you don't have to do much training. He's like, you'll just be running.
You just got to run.
Light you'll swim kinda, here or there. And he's like, that would be, he's like, you'll still get to compete. Cause that's where I'm like, I'm missing that. Like,
you like the competition.
Dude, I loved Saturday. Like, as grueling as it was, like, I fucking loved it. I loved every minute of it. And I just, I'm trying to be okay with that. I won't see that big mileage for like a year plus. Like, I'd love to do a marathon, maybe throw in a half Ironman.
I would imagine,
you know,
that you're committed to this.
Mm-hmm.
And that's with Kenny. We asked him how many he's done and the other things that he's done. You don't get good at Ironman in a year.
Mm-mm.
You don't get good at Ironman in like a couple years.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it might take like 3 or 4 years for you to become like
an elite. Like,
just to be good at competing, like, would you say Scott, the dude, he's a fucking savage
on the bike and the run, like absolute animal.
But those are the things that, like, but he's ran his whole life.
Yeah, right.
Like from young.
Yeah, he's a runner.
You weren't running 208 days ago.
No. So, no.
What I'm getting at is this is the fucking very, very, very beginning of your journey.
Yeah, yeah.
This isn't like, you know, there's people that were big time athletes in high school.
Mm-hmm.
That were just fucking animals. Yep. Some were D1 fucking athletes or D2 football players that could get out there and just fucking compete.
Yep.
You were never that person.
No.
So this is like you're 32 now.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I didn't even know how fucking old you were the other day, by the way.
Yep.
I was like, you're 30 something. I don't give a fuck. 30 couple, like Mike says.
Yep.
Like 30 couple.
30 couple.
Like 30, what is that? It's like a couple and 30.
Yeah.
All right. But like, so this is the very, very beginning of it all for you, which is going to be incredible to watch because it's going to be a process.
Yeah. I mean, Scott put it pretty well. He was like, because I was like, you know, what can I achieve in a year's time? What can I do next year? And this and that. And he's like, dude, he's like, you are building a base still.
Yeah.
He's like, you're just building a base.
Just learning.
He's like, you got a lot of time on the bike to get experience with that. Cause bro, that dude, they attack the fucking bike. Like, they are batshit crazy. Like,
it seemed like when I was watching the other people that were doing the fucking race, there were people that were like 27 miles an hour.
Fucking flying.
Moving. That's 30 miles an hour on a fucking bike.
Yeah, dude. It's no joke. So
no fucking protection. No knee pads, elbow pads. Oh no, they slow you down.
Yep.
You're going 30 miles an hour on a fucking bike.
Right. You know, and I've had no weight training the last like 5 months, six months, and weight training plays a huge role in improving in all of these events.
Yeah, all play.
So the new goal is just to take it easy for a few weeks, make sure everything's good at home, and maybe do a marathon in the spring.
Yeah.
And then just keep building upon it. I'm not in a rush. Like, I know I probably won't do a full Ironman next year. It's just not realistic.
Plus, you do want to compete with yourself to continue to get better. Yeah. I'd imagine that if you did one in 6 to 8 months or even a year, mm-hmm. probably wouldn't improve that much.
No, I could shave a lot off the transitions from getting better at that.
That was a joke, though. I was just fucking with you.
Well, no, it's serious, too. I mean, I could probably shave an hour and a half off of it pretty easily. Uh-huh. But I don't want to just shave that off. Like,
You want to become better known and shave off big time for your actual conditioning.
Yeah. Yeah, my conditioning. Yeah, like, I want to be able to not... I want to be like some of these, like, elite guys that don't need so much nutrition and hydration throughout the workout because my body's just humming on just whatever it's worth.
I just crack up because you were training, doing all these things, like you didn't get a medal for it. You got one fucking medal so far. Yeah. And you ran like 3 marathons.
I know, we were joking about it, like texting and stuff. I'm like, I've never got a medal in my whole life, at least nothing for more than just like
a participation medal.
And I was like, of all the things I could have done, like I could have gone and done a 5K, a 10K, a marathon,
You could have ran 10Ks every fucking weekend. I'm going to do a few 10Ks today, okay, everybody? Yeah. Can I get 3 of them?
Yeah, so my first medal, I had to do 140.6 to get it. But no, man, I feel blessed for the journey and
it's really cool.
Meeting so many. Dude, my shit was blown the fuck up. I didn't even know how to respond to people. Like the video that Sierra made.
Bro, how cool was that video?
Holy fuck, dude. Like they all saw it before I started running or before that day. And I'm glad I didn't see it before until after because like it would have just hit me differently.
Oh, yeah.
You know, emotionally. And yeah, man, the amount of support we have is...
We have such great people.
It's fucking unreal.
We have awesome people.
Yeah, we do. Yep.
It's so cool because, like we started, like, you're never an athlete. Mm-mm. There's so many people out there that are just normal people.
Yep.
Like we say, I'm stupid fuck from Western PA, dude. Mm-hmm. Being able to become a professional bodybuilder, I didn't have the most elite gyms. I still have the same goddamn stepper from 2009 when I started and bought the fucker for $300.
Yep.
You can do great things with minimal fucking equipment.
Yep.
You can do great things if you've never done it before. Mm-hmm. You can do great things in anything in life if you just put your best forward.
100%.
And you're going to be tested every single fucking day.
Yeah. Yeah. Like a couple weeks isn't going to go by without any like interruptions. And then you'll have like this like, no, it's every workout.
Probably a couple hours,
mm-hmm.
not like a couple days or a couple weeks. It's going to be intense.
Yep.
But that's also what makes us all great.
Yep.
That's what makes everything so fucking worth it and wonderful is, and who you are as a person. You find out more about who you are as a person through these intense adverse times.
Mm-hmm.
I found so much about myself through bodybuilding. I found so much out about myself through bad times. I found so much out about myself through building these businesses.
Mm-hmm.
You kind of find out who the fuck you are from pushing yourself. Yep. And it just goes back to being on the fucking merry-go-round or riding the roller coaster.
Yep.
And if you're a merry-go-round person, that's great. But if you're on the merry-go-round and wondering and kind of getting frustrated with it, mm-hmm. why don't you hop off part of that for a portion of your life and go ride a roller coaster, see what it's like.
Yep.
Because it's intense.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes that fucking, because you were climbing that goddamn hill this whole motherfucking time.
Yep.
And then like, I feel like you were on the front of the roller coaster.
Yep.
Climbing it, watching, doing all the training, just that slow fucking.
Yep.
And then all of a sudden, like race day, you're like, you kept looking over the window like as, and then race day, you're like on it. And it's like, all right, head first. You're number one in the fucking, you don't even know what's going to happen.
Yep.
Down as fast as you can, corkscrews, flips, all this over, and then all of a sudden it's over, and you're like, what just happened?
Yeah.
I knew I went in a couple flips and a corkscrew. Did you guys see that back there? It was wild.
I made it.
I'm done. Meanwhile, I was like, it's just a short portion of it, and now you're off the roller coaster,
mm-hmm.
and you're kind of like, I kind of want to get on another one.
Yeah.
Is there like another roller coaster here? I'd love to do it.
Yeah.
And Kim's like, let's just We're going to walk for a few miles and then get on the next
yeah.
one.
Yeah, can we hang out for a bit?
That's kind of how it all works. And the same thing happens with business and everything we've been doing. It's kind of like, Jesus, God in heaven, slow the fuck down. Mm-hmm. I really like it.
Yep.
And the thing is, if you are a roller coaster person, the people in your life realize that you are a roller coaster person.
Yeah.
And then they're like, okay, so I live with a roller coaster person. Mm-hmm. I don't live with a person on the merry-go-round.
Yeah, Kim said that to me. She's like, you are not a normal person.
No.
She's like, and she's like, I always knew you weren't. She's like, you go all in with whatever you decide to
do. A little
scary. But she's like, this proved it. You are not normal by any means.
No. And that's great because mm-hmm. that's what makes you who you are.
Yep.
Because, and that's what's important, because we need all these people to make the world go round. Mm-hmm. We need merry-go-round people. We need roller coaster riders. Mm-hmm. We need them all
yep.
to make the world go round. And it's just a matter of what you want to do. And it's not too late to be a merry-go-round person. And it's not too late to be a fucking roller coaster rider. Mm-hmm. It's just understanding who you are as a person.
Yep.
And I like to ride roller coasters.
So do I.
It's a little scary. Sometimes I get yelled at for riding too many mm-hmm. at like one time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because you can use that analogy with anything in life. Just my personality in general, when it comes to like, you know, same thing. When you commit to something, it's scary. Because mm-hmm. that means that everything else was turned off.
Yep.
And then it's, yeah, the roller coaster rides are intense and I think everybody should experience it. Yeah. I personally do.
Yeah.
I think everybody should go after something that is very intense and great because, mm-hmm. again, you find out who you are as a person.
Well, yeah, even if you don't get back on it again, you knew how it felt. You knew how it changes you no matter what, even if you do go back to that very consistent merry-go-round life, because now you might have kids, you might have that job that you always wanted to, and it's enough that you guys are always happy all the time.
It is, you know? Yeah, it's whenever you're on the merry-go-round, we're still consistent. Mm-hmm. We're still routine. Mm-hmm. That merry-go-round isn't the routine. Mm-hmm. It is your choices.
Yep.
Like you come work at Axe and Sledge and these companies, you're not on a merry-go-round.
No.
No. No. You're on a fucking, on a roller coaster because there's going to be opportunities. Mm-hmm. And guess what? Whenever you start out here, normally you're put on a very flat area to see what you're made of. Mm-hmm. And then there's going to be an opportunity that pops up, and it's up to you whether you want to take it or not.
Yep.
Because that opportunity can catapult you. That opportunity is going to make you accountable for certain things. Mm-hmm. And that's a scary thought, to be accountable for certain things. Because if you're accountable, you have to answer.
Yep.
And the people that you have to answer expect nothing but excellence. So it's intense.
It is.
Oh, fuck yeah. I love it. It's a
wild weekend, man. Still trying to process it all.
Oh, I couldn't imagine.
There was so many things that I wanted to, like, I said to them, like, said it out loud to myself. Like, I talked to myself the whole time on the bike, like, out loud. And I never do that. That's just
loud. Killing this fucking
And I'm like,
thing.
Oh, I can talk about this on the podcast. There was like 10 things that I'm like, oh, this is going to be funny. And I don't remember shit.
Oh,
like, I'm sure they'll come back at weird times, but
yeah.
I blacked out there for a while.
Yeah. Rick almost killed a guy.
I saw that. I need to lay low for a few days.
Mike want to lay low for a few days.
But no, man, great weekend. Thank you, everyone that followed along through Axe and Sledge, the demo crew, sharing everything. It was, I knew the support was there, but for everyone to be so vocal all in one day and everyone to be so engulfed in me personally for a full day, it was.
Fourth most track person at the Ironman. Fourth most
so
track
like
person.
A pro triathlete posted that. That she was on it and she was all excited. She was like number 20 or whatever. And yeah. I was like, I'd love to see like who's on there. I saw Chris at the top, the dude with Down syndrome. And then I'm like, no fucking way. I'm like Robert Dautrich, 144, right above the pro winner of the men's division. I'm like, this guy right now is like, who the fuck is Robert Dautrich?
Robert Dautrich from Avon Moore.
Oh man, it was humbling and
awesome.
Thank you guys and just
so cool.
Yeah.
It really makes you know, somebody put a whenever I was younger, I always used to I was really into movies and celebrities, things like that, like Arnold and fucking just all that shit. Sylvester Stallone, Jean-Claude Van Damme. And I always told my mom that, like, I wanted to meet these people, you know. And she'd be like, oh, that's great, you know, da-da-da, because I was just into it. It was cool. And then, like, I got older, and I realized that Jean-Claude Van Damme kind of liked to do blow.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, blow's bad. You shouldn't do cocaine. Yeah. And then, like, I kind of realized that these people that were celebrities, like, had bad habits.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, man, I wonder if they're, like, actually good people. And I never really knew or anything. But that's whenever it all started, that if I was ever going to be, if I ever got into that position, like, because then I started loving bodybuilding. And then I started meeting certain bodybuilders, and some were cool, some weren't. Some were just really monotone, simple people.
Yeah.
And, like, but they were, like, in the magazines, they were huge deals. Mm-hmm. You know, and I started learning all this, and I said, if I ever gonna get in this position, I want to be, like, just me.
Yeah.
And I'm an intense, I like fun, but I'm also a bit of a fucking prick. Mm-hmm. I'm emotional. I wear my heart on my sleeve and my emotions on my sleeve. Like, I'm outgoing, and I enjoy fucking with people. Mm-hmm. And you can fuck with me back. It's cool. Like, because I still got to go to work. Like, I'm not going to take too much serious. I can't.
Yep.
I wanted to be like my dad, like soul to the earth type of person. Mm-hmm. Like, he's always just going to be himself. And you either like him or you don't. And if you don't like him, he's going to be cool. Because guess cool. what? He's got way too many good things going on in his life. Mm-hmm. And I think that's how you and I and everybody here really handles this company and our customers. Yeah. And people ask us. I get other people outside asking, like, dude, like, what the fuck is it? And I'm like, bro, just be yourself.
Yeah.
Just be you. Mm-hmm. Whoever you are, exemplify that. Mm-hmm. Go do things that you just want to do to challenge yourself to find out more about yourself, the experience of life. Because if you experience it, you're going to find out more about yourself. Like when you were riding a bike, when you were in the ocean, you found more out about yourself in that water than you even knew who you were.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm not getting in that fucking water.
Yeah.
You got in the water. Mm-hmm. You swam out 1,200 yards in the fucking water. Mm-hmm. I'm not fucking doing that. Mm-hmm. You found, you experienced something.
Yep.
So these are things that are gonna, that can take people to do things and find out who they are, because, you know, I hate this fucking saying, you only live once, but bro, you ain't coming back.
No.
I don't think reincarnation's fucking real, because I don't remember who the fuck I was in a past life. Mm-hmm. So that means that whenever I'm here, I'm going to experience it, because I do not want to be a woulda, coulda, shoulda person.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and if you keep waiting to do it, you're going to run out of time.
You will.
You will, because big, great things don't take 2 weeks, a month, 3 months, 6 months, a year. They don't. They take
time,
lots of time.
And that's why I say this with every single thing that we built this podcast on and who we are. I don't give a fuck what you do. Mm-mm. If you're into it and you're passionate, I want to hear about it.
Yep.
I have certain things that I love in my life. Food being one. Restaurants. Take me to a restaurant. Let's go.
Yep.
I love it. I'm not going to be a fucking Ironman. I'm not running no fucking marathons. But I want to hear about them.
Yeah.
I want to know what it's like. I'm not playing football. I like throwing a pigskin.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd love to know what it's like, the real bullshit of being an NFL quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
Like, don't fucking sugarcoat this shit and don't tell me all the hunky duck fucking stories. I want to hear, like, the grit.
Yeah.
And we might not ever hear it publicly. People might not.
Mm-hmm.
But I want these, I want to, their experiences. Mm-hmm. Experience life, everyone. Go after something. Do something crazy. Do something fun. Live life with passion.
Mm-hmm.
You got to. Because he ain't coming back.
Nope.
Like I don't regret a goddamn thing.
Mm-hmm.
I might, I'm going to pay for a lot of the shit I did. But I'm living with regret won't be one of them.
Yeah.
Fuck no. So that means I might do a couple more crazy things. One thing before I'm going to die, I have to do these bucket list items. Because I want to know what it feels like.
Mm-hmm.
Like if I jump into fucking water in a cage and there's sharks in there, I don't know, my heart might explode.
Yeah.
But before I die, I'm doing it. So when I'm like 60, all my kids are full grown. Everybody's set up financially.
Yeah.
Hannah's probably will be up there being like, I've been trying to stop him. I'm going to jump in the water. And occasionally there's going to be sharks in there. Even if it's for fucking 10 seconds, I'm doing it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And then the boat will break down in the middle of the water and we got to swim back or some shit. Like, no, that fucking won't happen, but I think it might.
Mm-hmm.
But all these things, I think, you know, you got to make a list of things. You got to go after it. And you just, you got to live, dude.
Have to.
You have to.
Yep. You might find something along that journey that, like, you didn't even know you were going to pull from it. Yep. Like, your initial reason for starting it and doing it may be completely different by the end, and you're going to affect so many people along the way, good and bad,
mm-hmm.
that...
Bro, it's... Like you said, good and bad. There's going to be people that just won't like you.
Mm-hmm.
There's people that just don't like me. I don't really care.
Mm-hmm.
I can't, because I got too many good things happening. There's people in your life that might not like you. What are you going to do about it? You're going to fight for the attention of one person or even a dozen people.
Right.
Meanwhile, there's fucking tenfold the people that do support you, love you, think you're great.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you got to focus on those people and continue to build them, because they're the ones that are affecting their other lives.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's people that hate you or just dislike you. That's fine, because they're doing things in their life that are good for the other people in their life.
Mm-hmm.
So don't go chasing the negativity. It's okay. If you made a mistake, you made a mistake, dude. Own up, live up, and move on. Because everybody's going to make mistakes. I'm not done making them.
Nope. I'm sure as hell not.
Nope. I got to do cocaine with one more person before I die. The owner of Bang. And then I'm good. I just want to do blow with Jack. And then I'm cool. He definitely does blow. I don't know if he does. Here goes podcast, this fucking number going down. It's not going to be on there. Or fucking Jack from Bang's going to sue me. I don't want to get sued. I just want to go to Vegas and do blow with Jack.
There's nothing wrong with that.
No, it's great. I think that it's important for it's important for people to do good things.
Mm-hmm.
Moving on real quick.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're good. My parents went to Eddie V's for their anniversary dinner.
Yeah, how was it?
My parents don't do high-end restaurants.
Yeah.
They do some stuff, and for their anniversary, they've been together like fucking...
150 years.
Minus like 100.
Yeah.
Damn near half century.
Yeah.
40 plus years. 40 couple. They usually are somewhere exotic, like St. Martin, St. Thomas.
Yeah, they do a big
Florida.
Trip.
They usually do a trip for their anniversary because they just get the fuck out of Western PA, mm-hmm. go down somewhere sunny, all this shit. And my mom's like, we're not going to be anywhere this year, da-da-da. And she's like, yeah, it's okay. I'm like, why don't I set you up with a dinner down Eddie V's? And she's like, you don't have to do that. I'm like, just go to fucking dinner, for Christ's sake.
Yeah.
Get out of fucking Lower Borough. Go down to Pittsburgh. So I set him up, and I called Amanda and Brandon. I was like, hey, parents coming down, need an anniversary dinner,
mm-hmm.
all this shit. And I'm like, just make sure everything's cool.
Yeah.
You know, I paid for everything ahead of time, mm-hmm. and all excited. And they go down, and like, they sent me a picture of the table all set up.
Yeah.
Really nice for him. And then Brandon took care of him, the desserts, everything was good, the whole thing. Then my dad got a little pissed at the end because he couldn't give him no money because I paid for everything and tipped Brandon already.
Yeah. Oh, he was so pissed.
He's like, your dad was actually kind of mad. I'm like, fuck him. I was like, he can be as mad as he wants. I was like,
you, yeah, you, happy anniversary.
You have, yeah, oh, I just set you up and now I'm going to make you pay.
Yeah.
But he, so the next morning they called and they're like, I understand now. I get it. Mm. Why you talk about this place?
Yeah.
They're like, my dad's like, it was the greatest dinner I've ever had. I'm like, yeah, I know. Why the fuck you think I sent you? And he's like, no. He's like, it was so cool. He's like, it was
comes from the guy that doesn't like to eat out because your mom is such a fucking phenomenal cook.
He's like, your mom was in heaven. And she was so excited. And Hannah looks, she's like, I've never heard your mom this excited.
Yeah.
Like, they were pumped, like fucking killer steaks. Because my mom likes, she likes a filet with, Oscar filet with the crab and shit.
Yeah.
So she,
my mom loves
thing.
That too.
I don't get it.
It's a mom thing.
Yeah, it is. I don't know.
Yeah.
But she got it and they were fucking blown away. And then they were like, so we didn't order this, but he just brought it out. The crab fried rice. My dad's like, I didn't even know something could taste like that.
Yeah.
They were like, we didn't order, but it was awesome and this and that. And then he's like, he brought out the Bananas Foster and lit it on fire. I was like, my dad's just fucking... It's taking me out.
Yeah.
He's like, yeah. He's like, it was fucking awesome. He's like, it was crazy. He's like, greatest fucking steak I've ever had. And I'm like, I was like, pretty good. And he's like, I got the same thing you get. I'm like, what's that? Steak and scallops. And he's like, yep. He's like, oh. And Brandon was like, well, I know somebody else that orders steak and scallops. My dad's like, no shit, he does. I'm like, yep. They were fucking floored. They said it. They had so much fun.
That's awesome.
My dad's like, he's like, they treated us so well. I'm like, they treat the majority of everybody that well.
Yeah.
He's like, they're really good people. And he's like, they got my business. I'm like, yeah, so that's where you fucking go to eat. And he's like, yeah.
That's it. That's the only place they'll go.
He said, he's like, I don't think anybody does them like that. I'm like, no. I was like, we're really big customers for him, and we do it, but... My dad was fucking floored.
That's so great.
I was dying. I was fucking dying. It was pretty funny.
That's great.
Yeah.
Fucking Eddie V's.
Experiences.
Yep.
62 fucking years old and finally goes down there.
Yep.
2 years of me talking about it. Fuck.
Man, that's probably like the most excitement, like, you know, they get excited over other things too, but like that dinner, like, set them over the top.
Listen, for as many dad boring ass fucking dumb qualities that I have, that is him without the fucking mayhem that I am.
Yep.
Like, everything that I have comes exactly from him. Like, it's legitimately boom, boom.
The same.
Yeah, the same. And I'm like, oh, man. Because he's way more simple than I am about shit.
Did they go in the kitchen?
No, they didn't make it to the kitchen.
I didn't know.
Oh, God damn it. No, back in the day, my dad was a fucking wild man. He's fucking crazy. Nuts.
Greg. Oh,
good times. Yep. Experiences in life.
Hell yeah.
Well, cool beans. Yeah. Shainer, you have any questions for us today?
I do.
Shane had a couple good questions. I really wanted to ask you this one. It was on the last podcast with Dean.
Mm-hmm.
But a fan sent in a question that asked, say... that you and your significant other had to switch bodies.
Okay.
Like, you became Kim and Kim became you. Like, you guys woke up in the morning and you're Kim and Kim's you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what's the first thing you're doing?
I don't know if this sounds gay or not, but, like, I'd probably, like, want to have sex with myself.
Yeah, you're going to go fuck yourself, right?
I'm fucking myself?
Yeah, for sure.
Well, that's what we said. I was like, number one, I'm going to do research because I'm going to learn the vagina way better. I'm probably going to play with myself a little bit.
Yeah.
You'll be like, man, so this is okay. I like that.
Yeah.
Man, I've been doing it wrong this whole time.
Oh, that's what I needed to do.
Fuck.
Damn it.
And then I'd be like, all right, so, babe, I'm going to show you how to stroke this dick. I might even suck my own dick, but this is what I like. It's not weird, right? And she'd probably, I know what she would do. Hannah do the helicopter for 15 fucking minutes. She's like, do the thing with your dick. Do it.
I get why you touch this thing all day long.
This thing is amazing. Yep. She's like, that's what it feels like. Whoa. But yeah.
Man, that's a good, yeah, I'd do that.
What do you think Kim would do? What's the first thing Kim would do if she was you?
Fuck, I don't know. I don't know what she'd do.
Because every time it's like a half a chub.
She'd probably give it to herself, yeah. Like how she actually wants it.
Yeah. That's for sure. Yeah. Absolutely.
You think she'd go run an Ironman?
She might. Yeah, she might do like some functional leg things.
Yeah.
Fuck. Oh, man. That, right now, if we switch, I'd be like, fuck, dude, this leg.
This thing sucks.
Yep.
To go to rehab?
What? Yep. Ah. Oh, that's a good one. I don't know what else she'd do.
Oh, no.
Tall things.
Probably tall. Ah, yeah, good point.
Yep.
Hannah do semi-tall things.
Yeah. She'd be able to reach that shelf that she just can't reach in the kitchen.
She might eat two pizzas.
Yep, definitely. Yeah, she would eat all the calories in the world because I can just do that right now.
Yeah.
Kinda.
Yeah.
Yep.
Not, man, not anymore.
I got to be careful.
Yeah, probably.
I scaled everything back.
As a question, how much weight did you lose from the beginning of the Ironman to the end?
Yeah, so like they did weigh me in.
What'd you weigh it at?
It was like 190 or no 20 No, 203.
203 you weighed in at.
203, like 17 pounds lost, like race day. Like that my weight was even down like the day after, and when I got home like last night, it's still it's still down, and I've been pounding calories too.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's going to catch up. It'll just hit you one day.
Yeah. Oh, I'm waiting for it to bounce back. It's going to.
Yeah, it'll be ugly.
Yeah.
I hate that.
I just don't want to see like over a certain number and I'll be okay.
Yeah, just keep running.
Yep. Yep. Oh, man.
All right, Shainer. So we got some questions.
Yeah, fan questions.
I'm excited. There's been pretty good fan questions, not going to lie.
Would you rather have non-controllable hiccups for 1 hour every day? Or shit yourself one time out of the week at any given time.
Wait, how long am I having the hiccups?
1 hour, every day.
Every day.
Oh, or I shit myself once a week?
Yeah, but random time. Like, you have no control over that.
Nope, I'll take the hiccups, dude. I am not shitting myself if I'm out and about.
You can pick the hour, I guess. You get hiccups.
Yeah, if I'm at, like, the bank and I shit myself, that's a bad day. I'm, like, out. Doing something.
Even if I'm home and I shit yourself, it's like in your pants. Like, I don't even want to do that at home.
Shit's just so nasty. Like, SJ shits on himself all the time, and I hate cleaning it up.
Yeah.
I don't want to shit myself because it's way worse.
I'm not cleaning. I'm just throwing it out.
Oh, I'm going to throw it out and jump in the shower.
I'm throwing an outfit out every week.
Oh, those are my favorite underwear.
Yeah.
I like those jeans.
Yep. And it's like everywhere. Nope.
Nope. I'll take the hiccups.
I'll take the hiccups.
All right. Would you rather have a horrible job, but you're able to retire comfortably in 10 years, or have your dream job and you have to work every day till you die? Thought this was a good question.
I kind of got both right now.
Mm-hmm. I'm doing both.
I love my job. It's what I like to do, but man, is it fucking stressful.
Yep.
It's demanding. I'd like to be done in 10 years, but I know that won't happen.
No.
I'm a workaholic. I'm so much like my dad, there's no way I'm stopping work. There's just no fucking way.
No,
I'll never stop. I've accepted that because after seeing him last night and I talk about it.
No, I'll have to work. I'll work till the day I'm dead.
Yeah, I'll work till the day I'm dead. But I'll also make sure that I'm financially sound and create opportunity for everybody around me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right, last one.
My wife will want to kill me. My kids might fucking hate me. But it'll be okay.
Oh, I'll be all right. Fuck, marry, kill.
Hot. Jesus.
Oh.
Yeah, this sucks. Me, Pat, and Mike.
This is tough.
I'm not marrying Pat.
There's two things I want to do.
I'm not marrying Pat.
Two things I want to do with Mike. I just don't know which one. Can't take this personal, okay, Shane?
I'm not taking anything personal. If I'm dead, I'm dead. I don't care.
Shane's like, listen, I don't want to marry or fuck either one of
you. Yeah, so you can kill me.
Please kill
me. That's fine.
I'm not marrying Joe. He's a handful.
I was just going to say, I feel like he's going to give me a hard time for the rest of my life.
Forever.
Yep. And he's, I don't know, very competitive, always right.
Yeah.
Funny.
I'm not marrying him. Fuck him. Make me feel like shit.
I'm not fucking Shane. Just not. Sorry, Shane.
That's all right. I'm kind of happy.
I also don't want you dead. All right. I also don't want to fuck Pat.
Nope. It's tough because I'll marry Mike. I feel like he's the most safe bet about it. He's tall. He's handsome.
I know. Like, I would look good standing next to him the rest of my life.
Oh, Jesus.
But, I mean, all right.
You're right.
I'm gonna probably fuck Mike. Which I think he'll be happy with either way.
You got to kill show.
I know.
I got to kill him.
It's not personal. Like, he's older. He's seen much more than everyone.
I'm killing him.
Yeah.
I'm going to fuck Shane. Just because it's one and done.
Yep.
Get him out of my fucking life.
Yep.
And I'll take Mike forever.
I'm going to marry Shane and make him my bitch.
Jesus Christ.
Good, because I only fucked him once. You can have him sloppy seconds.
Oh my god,
that was a good one.
That's wrong. That's gonna make me fucking feel weird all the rest of the day when I look at Show and Mike. Not so much you. I don't care.
No, I'm leaving anyway.
I'm fucking out of here anyway.
Yeah, emotionless. Oh damn it. All right, everybody, appreciate everything. Make sure you do good shit. Work hard. Love your family. Do something great. Bye bye.
See you guys. Bye.